Sethuraman S. He completed his undergraduate studies from Thyagarajar College of Engineering. He pursued architecture with almost 5 years of practice and allied 3 years of professional architectural photography. He worked as an architect for Studio Kriya Architects Private Limited, which is a part of TVH Housing, Chennai. And he also worked for the Architectural Design Group, ADG, headed by A.R. Dhanasekaran, Chennai. He's also worked for many other organizations like Design Cube Architects, Carbon Design Consultants, and AIM Associates previously.
Welcome to UGC Lecture Series for Bachelor of Architecture. This is Vernacular Architecture, AR6007, Unit 3, Vernacular Architecture of the Western and Northern Regions of India, Part 3, Lecture 7. We'll be talking about the beautiful Kashmir of India. So, we'll be talking about an introduction to Kashmir, evolution of the capital city, a typical dwelling unit, as is important to study any vernacular architecture, the architecture style and method of construction, the spatial planning of the particular dwelling unit and the spaces formed of two or three dwelling units, architecture by region, houseboats, which are an important and rather very unique way of dwelling unit, factors affecting construction methods, evolution of Kashmir architecture, and so on. So, Kashmir, we all know, is the paradise on land and is famous for its hillside, excellent water bodies, its rich culture, Mughal gardens, shikaras, houseboats, handloom industry, its mouth-watering cuisine. It's also an important aspect or a location in terms of movies. The socio-cultural reason, the political aspects are all and a very, very appealing thing, such that it's been captured a lot in movies. So, Jammu and Kashmir is the topmost state of India. It is surrounded by Himalayas with China on one side and Pakistan. And Pakistan occupied Kashmir on the other, which is a never-ending and long battle. It basically comprises of three districts: Jammu, mainly a plain area; Kashmir, mainly a valley area; Ladakh, which is a hilly area. So, the hills, the valley, and the plain areas. So, essentially, these are the three most dictating factors in the vernacular architecture of Kashmir. So, you can have a look at this image. So, unlike other vernacular architecture, this typology dictates vertical growth of buildings. So, you have more than two or three stories. So, we talk about briefly the capital city. So, the river Jhelum plays a very important role in the formation and development of the city of Srinagar. The city has developed at a number of sites on the banks of the river and canals formed by it. So, as much as in a desert how a river is important, even in the mountain sides rivers are important and happen to be the life of civilizations. So, a network of canals extend through the city structure inward from the river's edge to the edge of the Dal Lake. So, you also heard about Dal Lake. The spatial structure of the city has evolved in harmony with the water bodies and topography. So, climate and geography is the most important factor in shaping the vernacular architecture. The river's edge is defined by buildings standing on retaining walls rising out of the water. So, we saw vertical growth of buildings. The main movement spine is formed by the river and parallel streets on both banks connected across by a series of bridges. Narrow cross lanes run perpendicular to the river. So, most of it came around the river. So, this is the picture of Dal Lake. So, we'll be directly jumping on to a typical dwelling unit. So, the buildings were generally 3 to 4 story high. As I said, as compared to the previous mansions or vernacular architecture, these are 2 to 3 stories high with basements contained with retaining walls along the riverside. So, when we come to topography, which is steep and varied, retaining walls are an important form of construction, which is obviously prevalent then itself. The plans were generally square so that a minimum of external walls were exposed and heat was conserved in the cold winter. So, when you have a rectangular or circular plan, it exposes a lot of your facade to the cold and the sun, for example. So, the plan was mostly square or a little bit linear. Bay windows are present overlooking the river on Main Street. So, windows were thrown out for the views and also to capture as much heat as possible. The Doob is generally located on the southern side so that the sun was available in winter. So it was an important aspect in terms of climate to capture heat to keep the building warm. The architecture style of this dwelling unit is rather very old and is existent even today. Even though a lot of buildings are being pulled down, these vernacular architecture building techniques are soundproof because of various reasons. We'll see. The oldest surviving example of traditional vernacular architecture in the city of Kashmir dates back to early 19th century. This architecture style is solely represented by the residences of the city and broadly falls into two distinct categories based on structural system involved. So the housing or the dwelling unit would basically divide into two types, and that based on the structural system. These two systems are called the Taak construction and the Daji Devari or timber braced system. So these two construction techniques was the most important aspect of the vernacular architecture. Why these are relevant even today is because Kashmir, I don't know if you know, is prone to earthquakes. Not as devastating as in Japan as such, but does have regular earthquakes and tremors. So in order to cater to this, by learning from their mistakes, by building and letting buildings be lost or ruined in earthquakes, they learnt slowly the technique to build earthquake resistant structures. So these two construction techniques are something that are very resistant to seismic activity. So these buildings are very relevant today. They happen to be precious, but are being pulled down in Kashmir. So as professionals, as architects, it's our duty to understand these systems. And maybe if we can't stop the political system behind pulling down buildings, we could at least be able to reuse these techniques in the building of dwelling units in such areas. So we talked about two construction techniques. We'll talk about the Taak. In this system, construction 2 to 3 feet thick brick masonry piers supporting wooden floor beams form the basic structural system of the building. So imagine piers. Piers are nothing but huge column based things. So you have basic brick masonry piers. So these columns make the walls or the enclosure between which spaces are formed. The space in between is formed becomes the window. So this is very simple. Brick piers with spaces in between, these spaces are either filled and closed or form the windows. So the distance between two brick piers used to be normally around 3 to 4 feet. So you have 2 to 3 feet thick brick piers with 3 to 4 feet in between, which is known as the Taak. The Taak is nothing but the window. The gap in between each Taak would be filled in with either a window opening or a brick masonry, as I said. The roof comprised a layer of earth covering over birch bark and wooden planks resting on wooden rafters. So you have wooden form or wooden planks which act as rafters, above which mud plastering or earth covering is laid over with birch bark. So this is the basic of a Taak construction. As I said, so you have brick piers. These are based with wooden rafters which act as pier platforms. And in between, the space is filled by a window or a door. So this is called the Taak construction. We move on to the Daji Devari construction. This is nothing but a framework. So Daji Devari construction is based on a braced timber frame structural system. So this is a simulated image of how a Daji Devari system works. Below, you notice you have a wooden framework. So that's the base on which normally 4 to 9 inch thick bricks or stone masonry is used to fill the gaps. So just above that layer, you notice bricks. So bricks or stone masonry can be used to fill these gaps, and this forms the basic wall. So this is called the Daji Devari system. Normally, the system is limited to upper floor levels or attics of the building. So this I'll tell you why. This is because these frameworks are something that can resist seismic activity. So the foundation or retaining walls or whatever, they hold the main ground. So even if that shakes, and does not, it usually doesn't break. If that shakes, the loose or framework sits tightly, which is a good way to resist earthquakes. So yeah, this is the Daji Devari construction. You notice the framework in which windows are made, and also brick work or stone masonry is filled. Next, we move on to the spatial planning. Spatial planning is very simple, as it is directly dictated by the topography. Most of the building constructed on the above mentioned structural system. So this is the basic construction system. Show a common spatial arrangement and therefore relative decorative elements. So the buildings can be divided into two categories, the square plan and the linear plan. So these are the basic two types of plans, which are aspects of the spatial planning. Many of the traditional buildings are based on a square plan with main entrance opening to a centrally located staircase lobby. So again, these buildings are used extensively in movies. If you had a chance to look at Roja, directed by Maniratnam, we go into spaces of the spatial planning of the Kashmir houses. So you enter the building, the staircase is such an important part of the whole dwelling unit. You notice that the staircase is the central part. It opens into rooms rather than doors. So a staircase goes directly into a room. That's how important the staircase is, because vertical growth, as I mentioned, is an important aspect. So the lobby is flanked by one or two rooms on either side, in ground as well as first floor. So the staircase is the main thing. So you remember in the movie, the terrorists take the protagonist around the place. So there are 2 to 3 rooms. It's actually wall-less and open with very temporary partitions. The space above the entrance and first floor in some cases also encloses a projecting wooden bay window. Bay windows or very open windows which throw out views are very regular. The second floor normally comprises a single large hall which can be subdivided into 3 smaller rooms whenever required with the help of partition screen. As I said, it's actually an open plan around the staircase in which there are partition screens. This is a very, very sketchy version of that. So you notice the staircase around which the house comes around. The second floor essentially is it has a sloped roof, as it is just treated as the attic and can be used as rooms. So this is an image of the same thing. So you notice the roof. Another thing is the building materials used. You'll notice that the present day buildings have corrugated iron sheets as their roofs, because that is more easily available. Initially it was wooden or wooden rafters with birch, but now it is mostly CGI. So the entrance to this building was from a staircase lobby located near one of the corners of the house. Many of the larger and more aristocratic houses, also known as havelis, comprise a linear 2 or in certain cases 3-story buildings. So that's how it developed. Initially it was actually an aristocratic status to have 3 or 4 stories, but later with urban chaotic formation, it became a necessity to go vertical. Lattice work screens and window shutters are some of the main architectural elements associated with them. The second floor is surmounted by a cruciform shaped attic space, as I talked about attics in the second floor. So we've talked about spatial planning and dwelling unit specifically. Now we'll talk about region specific architecture, because Kashmir dictates architecture in terms of region. So I talked about 3 regions, basically the plains, then come the valleys, and then come the hilly regions. So that's how we'll differentiate the architecture of the Kashmir. So we'll be talking about Kashmir Valley. Kashmir valleys are mostly rural areas. The major factors that dictate local architecture in valleys are easy to access, good soil for brick making and to water, and water and timber, snow in the winter, possibility of earthquakes. So these are the 3 factors. So the availability of the material, the snow, the heavy snow that is going to settle on the roof, and the possibility of earthquakes. As I said, earthquakes was an important deciding factor. As a result, walls are mainly made out of timber, bricks, baked or unbaked. So as I said, soil was available, so that resulted in baked or unbaked bricks, timber which was locally available, and the construction technique that was used where earthquake was not a concern was brick wall masonry with mud or cement mortar, that was basic, and unbaked brick with mud mortar and mud plaster. So this is very basic rural architecture. The Daji timber frame construction with infill of baked brick. So as I said, you have a wooden framework with baked bricks in cement mortar or unbaked brick masonry in mud mortar. Many structures which are typically single and double story have Daji walls in upper story and the gables. So you know what a gable is? The gable part of it is also filled with wooden framework and bricks. Roof slopes steeply in 2 directions. So basically the role of a roof is to just let slide the snow. Although planks or shingles of hardwood like deodar were formerly the main roofing materials, today CGI sheets on timber supports have become the most common type of roofing. So as I said, this is a typical valley or rural based architecture, 1 or 2 stories high. You can notice clearly that the final roofing or the uppermost roofing has become sheets, iron sheets, corrugated iron sheets, which is which became an important evolution. Next, we talk about the urban architecture in valleys. So we talked about valleys and rural architecture. Now we talk about urban architecture. So the urban areas of the valley have architecture that is distinct from all other areas. Why? Because we talk about vertical. So vertical growth or 3 to 4 stories high is a bare necessity because of the urban condition. The main factor determining the architecture is the high density of development. So the vertical growth. The two most common walling system observed are Dhaji and Thak, which we discussed earlier. Here we have an image of how many stories. So here the retaining walls. After the retaining walls, you have the next set of floors, and the above constructions are clearly Dhaji or mostly Dhaji in this case. So yeah, architecture by region, the Dhaji type. Timber frames and Dhaji walls are generally well laid out with a system of diagonal bracings. So diagonal bracings, other than just having grid iron bracings, was more effective. It provides a distinct path to the ground for the stresses caused by lateral seismic forces. In addition, the walls are lightweight and hence have less mass and less lateral seismic loads. So when it comes to earthquakes, the lateral seismic load is important. If the lateral seismic load is higher, when there is a shake, the building mass tends to shake harder and gets destroyed. But here it is lightweight and has less mass. Thus, this type of wall is able to withstand ground settlement and major earthquakes. The Thak type has a large number of windows. As I said, Thak means window, the space in between two piers. One in each gap between the piers. The roofs are 2- and 4-sided pitched. The wood shingle roofing that was once used in most structures has been replaced by sheeting. Finally, we talk about the hilly areas. We talked about valley areas. Now we talked about the hilly. The major factors that dictate local architecture in the zone are very contrasting compared to valley areas. Here, there is easy access to building quality stone. So you won't be going for cement mortar or baked bricks as such. You can use stone directly, which is available. There was limited availability of topsoil. So since it's a hilly area, the snow, the rain, the wind takes off the topsoil regularly. So that means you can't use that soil because it's loose. So it can't be used for making bricks. So varying availability of water ranging from abundant to very little. So the amount of water availability also determined the building typology. Better availability of timber than in other zones due to lesser deforestation. So in the hilly areas, deforestation is rather very less. So the availability of timber is much more. Difficulty in carting non-local materials. So in other cases, local materials or nearby materials could be sourced. But in hilly regions, this is very difficult. Hence, they keep to locally available or immediately available materials. Heavy snow in winter, possibility of earthquakes. So these are important factors. And the response that they come up with is coarse random rubble masonry with or without mud mortar and Dhaji wall, as we talked about. Historically, the flat roof has been the most popular on account of low snowfall. So if there is low or minimum snowfall, flat roof is very much good. But the escalating cost of timber, so compared to then, the cost of timber is higher today. So this again gives room for sheet, which can be easily carried out. Okay, so the unique part of Kashmir architecture is the houseboats of Dunga, houseboats which are called Dungas. So it's actually a dreamy setting to have a house which is a boat, but this is something that is very common. You must have noticed people who have photographs of tourists visiting Kashmir in boat houses. Those are not just for the sake of tourism, those are very much for living purposes. So living on a lake is one of the cheapest housing solutions in India. I don't think anyone would have thought of that. So living on a lake, living in a boat is a very cheap housing solution. Dungas provide closeness to nature and is comfortable and pleasant even when the lake ices up in the winter. So essentially the Dungas don't sail away. The boats are not in use. Boats are stationary. They are in one place. So it makes it very comfortable even if the water ices up. And of course, it's very close to nature because you have water and weeds and whatnot. So the houseboats in Kashmir are usually stationary, as I said. The Dunga boats are moored near the shore of Dal Lake, floating on a sea of green weeds. Okay. So the houseboats are generally made from local cedar wood. So boats are easy to make, much lesser volume and space occupied when compared to a dwelling unit. So that's easily available. Wood is used to make that. The houseboats are generally made from local cedar wood. Many of them have lavishly furnished rooms with verandas and a terrace to serve as a sun deck or to serve evening cocktails. So it has moved from being a cheaper solution to being something of a very comfortable and fancy setting. So this is a houseboat. So people just you wade in through a boat and climb up to the staircase, and that's how the boat is. It's stationary basically, but it's part of the house. So the houseboats are made of wood and have intricately carved wood paneling. So evolves, vernacular architecture evolves. First it was a boat, they lived in it, then they began to make it aesthetically pleasing, adding individual variety. The houseboats are of different sizes. Some even have three bedrooms apart from a living room and kitchen. They are provided with a balcony in the front, as we saw the balcony with intricate carved pillars. Virtually every houseboat in Srinagar has been provided with a municipal water connection. So from being vernacular architecture, it has been included in the cooperation of the city, the government and the governing bodies, and they have been provided municipal water connections. A portion of the roof can be propped up open to enhance the circulation of air. So these are still aspects of vernacular architecture where you can just open the roof. So this is not exactly always possible in a definitively designed piece of work. Most of the cooking in these houses is performed on the shore. Sliding shutters open for air and views. Vinyl partially covers the wall. These are more present day changes. So this is a very scenic pic of the houseboats. You see the weeds, the way the people enter, the balcony, the intricate carving of how it developed from a simple vernacular solution to a more intricately carved version. And now we talk about the factors that govern the method of construction. So we talked about it, how it can be a principle of design, how maintaining it can be an important aspect in vernacular architecture. We'll be talking about it briefly. So the factors affecting the construction methods will be obviously economics, which is money or the way to source it out, the maintenance of it, and the response to local natural condition. So it's again climate, economic conditions and maintenance. So economics, this is demonstrated clearly by the use of brick for construction, which is the most economical in the plains. The valley has soil and so it is easy to make bricks. You can either have it baked or unbaked. So the mountains on the other hand offer very little soil but have lots of stone and rock. So the economics dictate the architecture. Moving on, we talk about maintenance, which is an important aspect. In vernacular architecture, practical measures and procedural methods are already embedded in construction knowledge. When you put construction, when you go forward to construct a building in vernacular terms by doing it yourself, you know what the material is, you know how it works, you know how it stands. So it simply means you know how to maintain it, or you know, you understand how it is durable. So as local builders, they understood it in construction knowledge. They were actively involved and engaged in the building and maintenance of traditional built environments. So construction and maintenance was the same set of knowledge skills to them. Maintenance requires material and skills. There are no different from what is required in construction. The maintenance of rural structures is easy and within the reach of ordinary people. However, if materials from outside the locality were to be used, the maintenance of the structure would become expensive. And then we go on to local natural conditions. Winter, cold is an important aspect. Thick walls of brick and stone become important. Lighter pitched roof made of timber or corrugated iron sheets. Steep pitch of a light roof permits light accumulation of snow and prevents any water leakage. So these were the three important aspects that affect the methods of construction. You could study more elaborately about the evolution of Kashmir architecture. It happened from the beginning when there was just the topography which directly dictated architecture to present day individual variety that was applied. So this is about the evolution of Kashmir architecture. You can go through it. So coming to a conclusion, what we've learnt in this particular lecture is understanding the geography and heritage of Kashmir, the role of geography, physical condition in vernacular architecture, the ingenious construction methods which can be relevant even today, use of local materials, the study of the unique Dunga boat houses, and variety in vernacular architecture based on regional topography. The exercises that you could try out is make a detailed literature study of a Dunga boat house. It can be very interesting. Can allow you to develop creative ideas from it. understanding the Thak and Daji Devari construction and the role in earthquake resistant architecture. Earthquake resistant architecture is an important field to study today, and an answer was available long back. So I think it is important for us to look into that. You can also study a classification of various regions of Kashmir and its simultaneous consequence on architecture or construction technique. And also an important thing that we should all do is conserving the heritage of any region, in particular in this, with respect to this presentation, Kashmir's vernacular architecture, which is being toned down in large numbers. Thank you.